Good afternoon. Welcome to St. Andrew's Episcopal Church for the celebration of life of our friend Frank. Immediately following the service, we'll be having a reception in our Parish Life Center, which is directly behind us, and you're more than welcome. We will be having Eucharist during the service, and everyone is welcome to come forward to the altar rail, no matter what your faith journey is. Service will start momentarily. Thank you.
Thank you. mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on the mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his peoples will he take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that we may might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm, the 23rd psalm, we shall read together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Yea,
though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
I invite you now to pray with me responsively by Hover, Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom then shall I be afraid? Doers come upon me, eat up my flesh. It was they, my foes, who trembled and fell. Though an army should encamp against me, yet my heart shall not be afraid. One thing have I asked of the Lord, one thing I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. For in the day of trouble he shall keep me safe in his shelter. He shall hide me in the secrecy of his dwelling and set me high upon a rock.
Even now, my head, above my enemies,
therefore, I will offer in his dwelling an oblation with sounds of great gladness. I will sing and make noise to the Lord. You speak in my heart and say, seek my face. Your face, Lord, will I seek. You have been my helper. Cast me not away. Do not forsake me, O God of my salvation. Show me your way, O Lord. Lead me on a level path because of my enemies.
Deliver me not into the hand of my adversaries, for false witnesses have
What if I had not believed that I should see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living?
A reading from the Revelation to John. I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. these words in the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When I awoke early this morning to the gray skies and the darkness and fog that seemed to envelop the woods, with my heart settled on the work we all need to do today, to honor and celebrate the life of this remarkable man named Frank Mazzacua, I thought, oh, this is right. The earth should hold us in this womb of grief. The earth should shed her tears at her loss. And we should allow the world to reflect the melancholy of the spirit of our souls at Frank's passing. Even though a number of us haven't seen Frank in several years, somehow we just knew that when Frank was in the world with us, even when miles separated us, the world was a better place, a more stable and stronger place, a more loving place, a more true place. In fact, this morning when I woke and saw the landscape of the woods in the day ahead and the 1960s song, which I thought was sung first by the Beatles, but was actually recorded first by Skeeter Davis and then by Karen Carpenter, the song, Why Should the Sun Go On Shining, leaped into my heart. Exactly. Why should the sun go on shining? Why should the sea rush to the shore? Why should the birds go on singing? And why should the stars glow above in the midst of brokenheartedness? It is right and true to acknowledge our lament, to allow our hearts to settle into the profound loss of this treasured and beloved person, who we witnessed lovingly caring for his spouse, Jenny, who we saw as a thoughtful and devoted father, who leaped at the opportunity to live with his daughter, Eleanor, in Florida, and who the rest of us knew as a cherished friend in our lives. There is sadness in our loss, and there is rejoicing in the acknowledgement of the gift of life we shared with Frank. They are two sides of the same coin. The answer to the songwriter's question, why does the sun go on shining, is simple. Because of God's unfailing faithfulness. That's somewhat because it's only this unbounded love of God which can hold the enormity of our brokenheartedness, and it is also only through the presence of God, through time and prayer and the comfort of others, that God can show us how to authentically shout at the grave as we will today, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. It is through God's faithfulness that we will know God's comfort will surround and sustain us in our darkened days. And we can shout Alleluia because God promised through the voice and the life of Jesus that Jesus will raise us up on the last day. We know with certainty in our hearts and souls today that in death, whatever was broken has been healed. Whatever was lost has been found. Whatever was amiss has been righted. We know this because of Jesus' resurrection, that now inherent in every single ending is a brand new beginning with different and holy possibilities. And most importantly, we can shout Alleluia, Alleluia, because we know this, because each one of us in this room holds a piece of Frank's heart. And we hold it in our own hearts. And because God is love, all love and only love, the love we shared with Frank is, as God is, enduring and everlasting. This is God's faithfulness to us. And in response to God's faithfulness, Frank was faithful to the God whom he loved and served with an obedient heart, and faithful to God's people, whomever he met in whatever situation. Frank was trustworthy, honorable, strong in his convictions about how to live right, dedicated to his family. Open to new ideas, he was humorous, having often engaged us with that wonderful twinkle in his eyes. And he was a wonderful storyteller. Probably most importantly, at all stages of his life, he seemed to be able to receive love and to give love, making him a man generous in heart and spirit. Frank was able to both laugh and cry, understanding the fullness and the enormity of life's circumstances. He was able to be realistic and hopeful at the same time as his body began to age and made decisions about his own life out of his love for others. And maybe it's because I knew Frank over the last decade of his life, but it was clear to me that Frank was filled with wisdom. After each time I sat with Frank, or he contributed to our Bible study, or he offered a new and differing point of view in our conversations, or this is what I loved most, when I heard his voice, either in person or in the recordings, when he would read scripture, there was wisdom there for us all. And even when I would speak to him on the phone when he was in Florida, I came away knowing something profound and true had happened in that encounter with Frank, something that shifted and shaped my response to the world, sometimes by what he said, other times by what he didn't say, and oftentimes just being in his presence. Frank was a gift, freely given to each one of us time and time again, offered to us with grace and honesty and purposefulness. Today we celebrate the gift of Frank in our lives, and that gift does not end here. That gift of Frank will continue to play out in our lives, day by day, week by week, month by month, and year by year. We will continue to share what Frank gave to us with other people. And we will continue to tell the stories of Frank, not just because we want to keep the life of Frank alive to us, but rather because there is still truth to be found. There is still grace to be unraveled and holiness to be shared by the stories and life of Frank Mazzacua. In our gospel story today, Jesus proclaims that he is the resurrection and life. And one of the implications of that statement for us is that because Frank believed in Jesus, Frank believed that although he would die, he would also live in a new way. That gift of Frank's love will continue to be unwrapped in each one of our lives as we hold the truth of his being in our hearts and live his truth in all of our relationships. We each can go forward from this point of love, to continue to allow his love to shape our lives and our families. We can find comfort in the scriptures that we read today, that love never ends. That Jesus has indeed raised Frank up on the last day, and that life has changed, not ended. And now that Frank's soul is entwined with God's in a wholesome and complete way, Frank's steadfast love for each one of you never ceases. I invite you to lean into this place of love. When you need comfort, when you need strength, when you need peace, because it will be given to you by our faithful God. Lean into this place of love when memories just float into your heart, when at first they may bring you to tears. That's okay, because there will be a time when those memories will bring you joy. Lean into that as well, for that's of God too, of course. For we do shout, Alleluia, Alleluia. For we do know that Frank, who lived a faithful life of being an active member of a number of different churches throughout his life, but remembered most recently by us, of course, here at St. Andrew's, and offering himself to the service of God and his community with honor and humility, he was faithful and he was true in all of his relationships. He exemplified God's love incarnate, and now he is in the nearer presence of his Lord. And so we rejoice. Today we celebrate a long-lived life which touched hearts, which changed lives, and we give glory to God for this holy and enduring gift. We will rejoice that even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, 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 for in that statement of the power of Jesus' resurrection, we place all of our hope, all of our faith, and all of our trust that Frank's soul is at rest and he is experiencing the greater glory of the risen Christ. Amen. And now I invite you to please stand and join with me in the Apostles' Creed. In the assurance of eternal life given at baptism, let us proclaim our faith and say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Prayers of the people. Will the congregation please pray the parts in bold? Let us now pray for our brother Frank. Let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Frank, and dry the tears of those who weep. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Give to our brother eternal life.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother to the joys of heaven.
Hear us, Lord.
Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints.
Hear us, Lord.
He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother. Let our faith be our consolation, and eternal life our hope. Father of all, we pray to you for Frank, and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest, that light perpetual shine upon them. May his soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For to your faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy,
holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him.